And how could we do that to spread money more equally? Like, should we have an amount of money that's allowed to belong?
We have a very good method of doing that in Islam, right? We have a good method of distributing the wealth justly within the people in Islam, right? And that is a method that we call zakat. Zakat is a charity, is an obligatory charity that people must give, right, to the poor people. The rich people must give to the poor people, right? It's 2.5% of your wealth that you have to give annually, every year. So every year you look at your wealth, you give 2.5% of that wealth that you're saving, your savings if you're rich, and then you give it to the poor people of your community, your society, right? Of course there is enough. I'll tell you why. You know, they say that there is enough food in the world to feed the population of the world three times. But the problem is that people are keeping it for themselves, right? Yeah. So if you have someone like Bill Gates, right, the richest guy in the world, right, today, yeah? If he gives 2.5% of his wealth yearly, annually, we would have no issues. Just him just giving his wealth,
right? He does. And actually he has the opportunity to give much more than 2.5%.
But he doesn't, yeah.
Why he has that much belongings? Is it okay if somebody, he just... Like, in fact, he has a Microsoft and Windows, so he got a huge amount of money. And is that okay? It wasn't him who did that. It was all his engineers, his workers, and even the people that cleaned the facilities where all the people worked. So, in Switzerland, we had a vote for 1 to 12. That means if you work in a company, the guys that earn the less in the company shouldn't earn less than, I have to say it different, the guys who earn the most shouldn't earn more than 12 times the salary of the poor.
So there is a limit.
That means the CEO, as an example, if in Switzerland somebody who cleans the facilities gets 50,000 Swiss francs. So that means the CEO shouldn't get more than 600,000 Swiss francs. And you can live good with 600,000 Swiss francs. Why you should have 100 million a year? And can you be responsible to earn such an amount of money? What happens if your company gets broke down? Do you have the responsibility for all the people? You feed them when your company broke down. No.
That's a very good point. But how would you control the distribution when you look at the effort that people put in? So for example, if I put...
I don't know what's going on. Like,
for example, if we say that you put 50 hours of work per week, and he puts 2 hours work per week, and you try to limit the person who gets 50 hours, he puts 50 hours of work per week, you say you cannot have 12 times more than the one who works 2 hours.
Yeah,
and then he says
that's just an amount of hours, what he does in this time. So when I work 50 hours and I'm destroying environment completely because I want to get money, and I work just 2 hours, my footprint is very small, maybe I'm much better for society, for environment, for everything, just working not that much. And I think it's just the wrong idea people have.
I completely agree with you. You know, Islam is focusing on the afterlife, right? Yeah. Not focusing on the materialistic life and the materialistic world. The Muslims, majority of them, believe if you have enough for your food, for your sustenance, for your house, that's enough. That's enough. And you can live a very happy life with that. You don't need to be the richest guy or the most rich guy in the world. But also, Islam does not really restrict the people who are rich. Why? Because it forces them to disturb it from their wealth on an annual basis, which then allows the poor person not to live a poor life, right? So if everyone is living an okay life, they have a house, they have food, they have whatever they want, and you have a few rich people wouldn't complain. But people are really complaining because of the disparity between the both, right? Between both. One is very rich and one is very poor, right? That's the problem. But Islam fixes the issue. It doesn't leave a poor population in the world.
That's a very good idea and a very good option. But I think it's not enough. And as long as you have people, they just earn money with doing like coal mining, as an example. You get a huge amount of... Or other example, just the rents in Switzerland.
Yes.
We earn the rents with investments that would force a 6-degree... that the Earth could get 6 degrees warmer. So you destroy it completely. And it's just rent. How these people should be interested to change something, because they want to get their rents, they want to have a life, they want to have to keep their houses, they want to eat.
I think I get your point now. Your point is working too much and destroying the environment in the same time.
What's a good way of living? I agree with you. Like, there's an enough.
We're in agreement. We're not in disagreement. Yeah. We're completely in agreement.
There's an enough. Yeah. And I think it's, if somebody has too much, giving the poor, that's very cool.
Yes. But you know, Islam makes it an obligation. The difference is this, right? There is a voluntary charity, which is from your own heart, you give it away, like you're talking about Bill Gates. And then there is an obligatory charity in Islam, which is you have no choice, you have to give it, right? So Islam makes it an obligation. Why? Because the rich doesn't say, I don't feel like it. You give charity, I give £1 yesterday. That's not charity, right? You have to give enough amount of wealth for these poor people. But I'm agreeing with you completely. If you're talking about destroying the environment while gaining the money, we say that's completely wrong. But I'm saying if someone is working, consider this example. If someone is working, he's not destroying the environment, he's not causing pain to anyone else, he enjoys what he does as work, and he's not in shortcoming when it comes to his family. So he's not on the expense of his family, he's working. No, he's just working and he's taking care of his family, right? And he makes a good amount of money, perhaps more than another person. I personally wouldn't find a problem with that, right? I'd say, okay, you can make money because...
I come out...
By the way, we're Muslims. Can we ask what you believe? What's your background? Respectful.
I'm agnostic.
Okay.
No, but
same for yourself?
He's honest.
He's agnostic, not atheist. Okay. Agnostic, sorry.
Okay.
I grew up as a Christian. And I agree with some, values. I agree with a lot of values of Islam, but I'm not. I have a lot of students. They're Muslims. Probably the half, or even three or four. So I know their families. I value that a lot. But I'm not really into. I were all the time. I was into defining life for myself. I see your point, and I see points of others, and I just want to have a good life together with other people. That's why I'm thinking.
100%. What you're saying, what you're describing today, what you're describing right now is humanism, right? She's living a good life, and that's what you describe, right? But I think his question is more about. Is the purpose, the objective purpose for existence of human beings. Like there is, we believe there's two types of purposes, right? A subjective purpose for life, which is you can have your subjective purpose, you want to be a doctor, you want to be a pilot, that's your subjective purpose, right? Then there is the objective purpose of why the creator, if we believe in the creator, obviously, yeah? The creator have created the creation. For example, the bag that you have with you, right? The manufacturer, the maker, what did he do? He ascribed purpose to it, right? The phone, why does it work in that way? Because the maker and the manufacturer decided that this will be the purpose of the phone. So whatever you make, you give purpose to. So we believe we are created by a higher entity or a higher being. We don't believe he's a man or a woman. We don't believe God is a human being like us. Yeah. Don't believe he died by his creation. No, you don't believe that, right? So we believe that Allah ascribes the objective purpose for us because he's the one who created us. Uh-huh. Therefore, there is an objective, collective purpose for humanity. So I believe that's what he was asking about.
Question.
Yeah, the initial
I
question.
I could agree with that. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. What I don't never agreed, I don't know why, but
yeah.
What
tell
I mean,
me, yeah,
like some, that somebody yes. could tell that for all the people. Because if you have a look at the Bible and if you read it,
is it okay? I'm sorry to stop you. Would you say somebody? Do you mean a human being?
Like also a prophet or whatever.
No, not a prophet or a human being.
Not your prophet.
Okay. No, even the prophet is not the one who tells us what to do. The prophet is just...
We believe to be... Sorry,
he's just the one, for example, because we can use the scientific argument to say that the universe is space, time, and matter, right?
So what we say... That's a separate topic, Akhi. The point we're making is that the prophet... Yeah, we're saying the same thing.
We're saying the same thing.
The prophets are not. I'll tell you why I stopped at that. Because we agree with you. We're not saying that a human being is the one who dictates to us what to do. We don't believe that. Right? The Quran says about Prophet Muhammad, he says, وَمَا يَنْتَقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى. He does not speak of his own. It's only revelation revealed to him. The Prophet, he says, I'm nothing but a human like you. The difference is that God is revealing to me the moral aspects of life. purpose of life and guidance for human beings on what to do. So we completely agree with you. No human being should have a superiority over the other human being just by himself to dictate to them what to do. But the creator can tell us what to do. Why? Because the person who made the phone, let's come back to the example of the phone, he gave us a manual with the phone. Why? He's the one who made it. He knows every little specific detail of the phone. He knows what is good to do with the phone and what is not good to do with the phone. If you come across an issue with the phone, you go back to the manual, okay, this is how you solve the issue, right? Allah gives us a manual for our existence as well as human beings. Because we're not perfect. We don't know every moral good things and morally bad things in life. We don't know everything, right? So Allah sends prophets, what to do? To be an intermediate, to give us the message. That's their job, right? To give the human beings a message. We don't worship them. We don't call upon them. We don't do these things, right? We worship the Creator alone. It's the essence of Islam. Essence of Islam is monotheism alone to the Creator. Worship to God alone. Seeking help from the Creator alone, right? That is the basic core message of Islam. So if you say like that a person should dictate to us, a human being like us, we say no, absolutely not. But God can tell us why. God, when we know God has attributes, right? We believe Allah is Al-Hakim, the All-Wise. We believe Allah is Al-Alim, the All-Knowledgeable, right? We believe Allah is the All-Merciful, the All-Just, right? These are attributes that Allah has, and we don't have them. We have limited knowledge. We have limited eyesight. We have limited intellect, right? Everything we have as humans is limited. Therefore, if there is like is your son, right? When you tell him to do something good, he does it based that you have more experience, more wisdom in life than him. Right? So he takes what you tell him to do, he does it based on that, correct? The Creator has the ultimate wisdom and knowledge and experience, right? So if he tells us to do something, we follow it based on that, right?
But how does he reach you?
It's a good question. Very good question. That's why we come back to the point of prophets, right? Prophethood. Prophets are the ones who come to connect humans with the Creator. The difference between us and prophets is the following. They get revelation from God. And the Creator tells them to deliver the revelation they got from the Creator, right? Not only that, they have evidence to prove they're prophets of God. So if I just tell you I'm a prophet right now, follow me, you say, what's the evidence for you're a prophet, right? You can say that, he can say that, everyone can say that, right? But if I produce to you something miraculous, something that other human beings cannot produce, that you know must be from a divine entity, then you accept the claim I'm making and you go with me, right? Correct? Do you agree? So that's how we follow things. Prophet Muhammad brought evidence to prove he's a prophet of God. We believe in the previous prophets as well. Jesus, Moses, Noah, Abraham. We believe they're all prophets of God. But their evidence, we restrict it to their people. For example, I'm sure you know about this. Jesus was raising the dead and we were healing the sick and the blind. That's what the Bible says, right? So that was an empirical evidence. Empirical, the five senses, the eyes and the hearing and the sight. Something that you can see only if you're at that time. Today, if I tell you believe in Jesus because he healed the sick and the blind, you say, I haven't seen it, right? And I say that's a valid point. I cannot force you to believe in something that happened in the past, right? By necessity, especially if it's a miraculous act, right? But Muslims have evidence that you can view today, can look at today, objective. When you look at, you come to the conclusion that Prophet Muhammad is a prophet.
Could you explain me one?
Sorry?
Could you explain me one? Just give an example.
Yeah, sure. There is types of evidence. A lot
so
of,
many.
Yeah, there is types of evidence. And within the types, there is evidences within all of these types, right? Like, for example, we have predictions of the future. Do you agree with me that human beings do not know the absolute future? Would not be able to tell what's going to happen in the future correctly every time, clearly? Would anyone be able to do that?
I think Google can tell you what happens in the future. quite accurate calculate what happens in future. Yes. So that's quite
calculate mathematically. You mean mathematically? Huh? Calculate in what way? Because our human behavior is not something that you can calculate because it's not consistent, right? Like mathematics.
It's consistent enough.
Okay.
And that's quite scary. I don't know.
So can you give me a prediction in your mind of something that we're consistent about? Are you saying, looking at the environment, looking at the society, and then coming to a probable conclusion of what these people might do? That's what you're saying, right? We don't mean that by a prediction of the future. What we mean is absolute knowledge of what's going to take place. Not a maybe yes, maybe no, that maybe it will happen, one of the things you said happened, one of the things you said didn't happen. No, we're saying everything you said must take place. Must actualize, right? Because if I'm getting it from the Creator, he absolutely knows what's going to take place. So if he says X is going to happen, it has to happen, right? If it doesn't happen, it's proof that you will not get a revelation from God. Right?
Do you mean then it depends on how many prophecies you do?
Okay, yeah, I'll give you my criteria.
You
tell me.
100 prophecies, sure. 10% are true then.
That's a good point. We have forces. We have few criteria for the predictions, right? First criteria is predictions are not self-fulfilling, which means self-fulfilling, which means I say this is gonna drop on the floor, then I drop it. And I say, look, I predicted this is gonna drop on the floor. That's a self-fulfilling, you made it yourself, you self-fulfilled the prediction. We don't agree with any predictions like that, right? Okay, self-fulfilling predictions we don't accept. Ambiguous, unclear contradictions. We don't agree with predictions. Like Nostradamus when he said the red lion is going to defeat the X on the mountain, right? And then we saw a battle, some people were wearing red, they said that's what he predicted, right? It's very vague. You can't apply it to anything in life, right? It has to be specific, it has to be clear, right? It has to be numerous. Many predictions, which is what you were saying. It has to be tens of predictions, for example. Number of predictions, none of them can be false.
An example for that?
I'll give you a couple of 100%. I will 100% give you. Come to the example.
I'm
putting the criteria. I'm setting the criteria and saying if you agree or you disagree, right? Then the last prediction is that the person himself is known to be truthful and honest with his community. He's not a person who's known to be evil or bad, etc. Right? These are our criteria for someone predicting the future, right? You agree they're objective, they're fair, they're okay? Okay. Yeah, sure. Let's move on now to some of the predictions of the Prophet Islam. By the way, that's just one type of evidence, right? Islam has other types. But I'm just giving you one type of evidence, objective evidence, to prove, which is enough, I believe. One type of evidence is enough, right? Prophet Muhammad said that you will see the barefoot Bedouin Arabs competing. So now he specified the people. Bedouins are people who live in the desert, they have tents and things like that. He said the Bedouin Arabs, because not all Arabs are Bedouin, he said the Bedouin Arabs will be competing in building the tallest buildings.
The tallest building,
yeah. Everyone trying to build a building taller than the other one. What is the tallest building? By the way, he said that 1,400 years ago. We have that recorded, carbon date, the first century, second century of Islam, right? So it definitely he said that a long time ago, right? Over 1,300, 400 years ago. So where is the tallest building today in the world?
Yeah, of course.
Sorry?
Yeah. Okay.
What is that?
You could argue that.
Yeah, Burj Khalifa, yeah.
For example, attempting to make us build these tall buildings. However, he was a humble person.
We'll come 100%.
That's
step by step. So what we say, because I've not finished the contradiction, there's more to it, right? Some people stop there, I don't stop there. There is more to it as well, right? So now, the Arabs at that time, they used to hide from the heat, they built buildings in the floor, right? We were not known to build tall buildings. They were not people of civilization. That's what Bedouins are, right? People who don't live in the desert without any civilizations, right? We had the Roman and Persian Empire. There were people known of civilizations and structures. If the Prophet, you wanted just to make a guess, he would say, which is what you were saying, looking at the population, looking at the people and predicting something, he would say the Bedouins, the Romans and the Persians would be competing because they're known to build tall buildings and everything, right? But he didn't. He said these Arabs barefoot, look at his description. He said barefoot, they walk in barefoot, they don't have even shoes, and they're walking in the desert. These people you're seeing, they will be building the tallest buildings, right? So not only that, why are they able to build tall buildings? What gave them the capacity to be able to build these tall buildings?
Money?
The capital.
Thank you, yeah. They found oil, right?
Yeah, of course.
So 50 years ago, Dubai was a desert. There was no buildings or no civilization. They didn't find oil yet. When they discovered oil, they changed to the Dubai that we know today, right? Now, the Prophet, he said, the earth will puke its treasures. So he didn't only say that they will be competing in building tall buildings, but he said the earth will extract, will give out. Puke means like puking, right? It will extract its treasures, right? He didn't stop there. He said, يَكْثُرُ فِيكُمُ الْمَالُ وَيَفِيدُ. He said that money will become abundant within you. So he didn't only tell them what they will be doing, which people will be doing it, and the action they will be doing. He also said that why they will be able to do it, right? Which then these are all criteria that makes you know for sure that he's not just making a prediction of the future. Why?
That's actually pretty cool. I will read that.
I'll give you more predictions. I'll give you more predictions differently. I'll give you also references as well. So,
do you have the time for me?
Yeah, I'll be 5:11.
5:11, yeah.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, so no problem.
Because we have to reach a train.
Yeah, that's all right, no problem. Whenever you have to go, tell me you have to go, right? So, another thing is that the oil, I'm adding more to the same prediction. The oil was not of value until the discovery of technology that we have today. It was just some, the Arabs when they found it, just some you know, some black things coming from the floor, right? It was not really of value used as energy as it is used today until we have all of this equipment and technology that we have today, right? So that is another layer of the prediction, right? Another prediction, Prophet ﷺ, he said that this land of the Arabs will return again. Rivers, meadows and rivers and gardens. Now he said that 1,400 years ago. He said that they will return. What does it mean if he says they will return?
I think it's just like they're watering the whole desert and to destroy the environment, I think.
But when he says it was before, oh, okay. He will return. If something returns, then it existed before and then it will come back. So he says, when he says it will return, he's implying, he's telling his people that it was before. They were living in a desert, they don't know about the past, right? But he's not just telling them about the future, he's also telling them about the past. He says that in the future, it will be like the past. It will come to be in rivers again and meadows. Now let me show you some of the what NASA says and what Nature magazine says about the deserts of Arabia in the past, right?
There used to be woods.
So,
and gardens. Oceans.
Yeah, this is the natural cycle.
Okay, so revealing the grain past of Arabia, yeah? Now, when you look here, do you know what they say? They're giving us 10,000 ancient lakes. They're saying 5,000 years ago or more, these are fossils, we're going to talk about them. They say there was 10,000 ancient lakes back, right? They found, they discovered 10,000, how? Through satellites. Using satellites.
Can I ask you after that?
Yeah, of course. Question? Yeah, 100% you can.
So if somebody proves that well,
yes.
Does he have too much power then?
Sorry? Yeah. You mean if he predicted the future?
If somebody proves to you, he's right.
Yes.
So
he's a prophet of God, you mean.
So you get a believer then?
Yes.
Because he's right.
Yeah, you get to accept his claim.
Does this person have too much power then?
Good question.
People?
Good question.
No.
Let me answer that.
You have to trust him.
Good question. Let me answer
you
that.
You give me an answer for yourself.
Yeah, I'll give you an answer. No problem. No, I'll give you an objective answer.
Yeah.
Because the prophet existed at one time, right? And he brought evidence that he's a prophet of God. So we can look at his life to know how he behaved when he had the authority that you're referring to, right? The prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, Aisha, which is his wife, she said that there used to be 3 moons, 3 months. The goal passed by in the house. We have no food except water and dates. He had control over Medina, he had control over Mecca, everyone was under him as the Prophet of God, as the leader. And 3 months, he just eats dates and water. The Prophet died and his shield was with someone that he rented it with. He gave it to someone and he took money from him. Yeah, so he wasn't even with him. He died and he has his rent somewhere else. He died without anything. That's the Prophet that we believe in. The people, when they entered on the Prophet, they used to ask, where is the Prophet? Because he's sitting down, he looks exactly like the people sitting down. He has no clothes, he's not sitting on the... He said, where is Muhammad? Where is the Prophet? Then the companions, they say, is this one, right? So people could not even know or recognize the Prophet from the other common folk. That's how he lived his life, right? So the Prophet, he had the authority, but he was a prophet of God. And God chose him for that reason, because he knows how he will behave with the people, with the community. Now, the Prophet ﷺ said, "La tutruni, do not overpraise me." Like the Christians overpraised Jesus and they elevated him to be God. So the Prophet commands us not to overpraise him. The Prophet, he says, "Do not say I'm better than Jonah, Yunus." Yeah, do not say I'm better than him. Do not say I'm better than Moses. So he's saying, do not make me better than other people. Do not elevate me in status, right? So we as Muslims, we believe the honoring of the Prophet place that Allah put him in.
Yeah.
Not to elevate him more and not to degrade him less.
Yeah.
Right? That's what we believe. And that's how the Prophet behaved, right? With his people.
That's what I like about Islam.
Yes.
So, like, really a lot.
Yeah.
Because it's more equal.
Yes.
Jesus got institutionalized to overpower people. I know that.
So, you know, as a colonialistic purpose, you know, let's preach Christianity to the rest.
You find this as well in Muslim communities,
for sure.
But it's not the idea.
Exactly, it's not Islam. It's not Islam. It's the Muslims, some Muslims.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly.
But defend the Muslims and defend Islam.
Yeah.